بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، رب السماوات والأرضين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد خاتم النبيين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته أجمعين وعلى كل من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما، سبحانك اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه، وبعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. As the brother was saying, that today's session, inshallah, is a continuation of yesterday's session. For those of you who were present yesterday after Salatul Maghrib, you may remember that I kind of gave an introduction to the whole theme of the week, of the weekend retreat. The importance of learning about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then that resulting in us having love for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then loving the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would entail in turn result in us following in the footsteps of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then I talked about briefly the akhlaq, the character, the characteristics, the manners, the behavior, the conduct of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today I want to specifically deal with the interaction and the dealing of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his spouses. And I want to look at this topic from both sides. From the side of the man, the husband, and also from the side and angle of the woman. Because the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a husband. And we look at him as a husband, how he dealt with his wife. But at the same time, the same teachings and the same guidance given by him relates to a woman dealing with her husband. So we're going to look at this topic from both angles. This book, which I'm basing these discourses over the last 2 days, this book, Sayyiduna Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's a chapter here where the author says, كَرِيمُ عِشَرَتِهِ وَحُسْنُ مُعَامَلَتِهِ مَعَ زَوْجَاتِهِ وَسَائِرِ أَهْلِهِ. The nobility of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's dealings and his nobility in his relationship and his interaction with his family. حُسْنُ مُعَامَلَتِهِ, his good dealings and his good interaction with his family, dealing with spouses, and the rest of his family. And then the author mentions that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was extremely noble and extremely gentle and extremely polite in his dealing and interaction with his family. As we learned yesterday, that he was polite and gentle with everyone. But when it came to his family, he was more gentle. He was noble in his conduct and his behavior. يُلَاطِفُهُنَّ وَيُمَازِحُهُنَّ. He used to be gentle with them. He used to joke with them. He used to be light-hearted in his interaction with them. وَيُعَامِلُهُنَّ بِالْوُدِّ وَالْإِحْسَانِ. He would deal with them with love, with mercy, with gentleness, with kindness and politeness. And then there's a hadith which Imam al-Tirmidhi radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates from Aisha radiallahu anha. She says that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. An amazing hadith. خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best amongst you is the one who is the best with his spouse, with his family, with his wife and the children, and likewise with the husband. خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. And then he says, وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. And I, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is saying that I am the best to my family, to my wife. And there's a extra part in another narration where he says, "ما أكرم النساء إلا كريم ولا أهانهن إلا لئيم." This is an amazing part of the hadith. ما أكرم النساء إلا كريم. Only a noble person honors women. ما أكرم النساء إلا كريم. Nobody honors women except that he is noble, and none degrades women except that he is evil or he is a wicked person or an evil person or a wretched person. لئيم. ما أكرم النساء إلا كريم ولا أهانهن إلا لئيم. In other words, the human being who is noble in his conduct with his women, the one who is gentle and good in his behavior towards women, is considered to be a noble individual. And the man who does not treat his women in a gentle, polite, kind, honorable manner, then he is considered to be a wicked, evil, and wicked person. And you see this whole issue here. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him as a mercy to the mankind. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you except as a source of mercy. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from head to toe completely a form of rahmah and mercy sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a riwayah, there's a hadith where he says, إِنَّمَا أَنَا رَحْمَةٌ مُهْدَاتٌ. I am a mercy that's been gifted to you. Just imagine, subhanAllah, I am a mercy. Allah sent this gift to us. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a gift. Who is the giver of the gift? Our Lord and Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the gift is given to us. He is a gift. إِنَّمَا أَنَا رَحْمَةٌ مُهْدَاتٌ. And this gift is mercy. He is completely overwhelmed with mercy. His interaction is based on mercy. He deals with mercy. And his teachings are filled with mercy and rahmah. And this is what his teachings and his guidance is based on. And this is what he's trying to inculcate and instill in our hearts and minds. That, oh my followers, you need to have this mercy in your hearts and minds. If a person, if an individual, if a male or female, I mean, today we have so many problems, marital problems. I mean, I deal on a regular basis with marital issues and divorce issues. The rate of divorce, you know better. It's so difficult in this day and age for marriages to last. I know a situation just recently, this was just, I think, a couple of months ago. A young couple got married 2 days and divorced. I said, Alhamdulillah, at least it lasted for 2 days. Some marriages don't even last for 2 days. The first day, divorce takes place. 2 days and divorced. On the first day, they're divorced. Why? What's the reason? Why were marriages maintained previously? Why are there divorces now? There are many reasons. But one of the main reasons, the main core, and I want to talk about this issue, you know, this point. The main core reason is that we, as human beings, we have forgotten our responsibility of dealing with others with mercy and rahmah. We just always want our rights from other people. We have forgotten to give rights to others. We want just our rights. Beforehand, we have preconceived intentions from before getting married. The husband, you know, knows, I want to get married, I'm going to be quite strong, you know, I'm going to be the boss in the house, and my wife, she will not be able to do this, and she can't do this, and how the rules will be set down by me. Beforehand, the intention is all based on, you know, taghlir and shidda, and with extremism, beforehand. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did Allah say? وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضْلًا غَرِيبَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْ فَضْلُ مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. He wasn't ghareeb, he wasn't harsh and hard-hearted. Beforehand, and the woman as well, beforehand, she, you know, the mother and the family people are just putting and drilling into in her mind, make sure you stand up for your rights, and when you go there, you don't want a mummy's boy, a mom's boy in marriage. Beforehand, intentions are wrong. How will a marriage last? If the intentions are incorrect and wrong and un-Islamic before you actually get married, then how will this marriage last? We need to think about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I get married, I will treat my spouse to the best of my ability. That spouse of yours, we need to think before marriage that first of all, this is a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have been ordered and commanded to deal with everybody with rahmah and mercy, let alone a Muslim and then our spouse. Let alone a human being and then a Muslim and then a spouse, even with animals. Animals deserve respect and honor and mercy and rahmah and gentleness and politeness. Let alone your own husband or wife. But beforehand, and this is what we need to do, we need to, before marriages take place, we need to purify our intention, purify our heart, cleanse our heart. This is a spiritual problem connected to the heart. Spiritual problem connected to the heart. Hearts are not clean. We have not spiritually purified our heart. Allah says in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. The one who has purified his soul, his heart, is the one who will attain and achieve and gain success and salvation. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. And the one who distorts his heart is the one who will be unsuccessful. This is the problem. We need to purify. Sorry about this. We need to purify our hearts and our minds before we get married. This is a spiritual problem. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Before marriage, correct your intention. For those who are not married and those who are already married, remember, it's never too late. You can be married for 10 years, you still have a chance to renew your intention, inshaAllah ta'ala. You know, there was a person who was asked, he was married. Somebody asked him, you know, he was married, he got married, somebody asked him, how's it going? How's marriage life? Like they asked. He said, I'll tell you later on. Ask me about after 6 months. I don't really know right now. So he said, okay, I'll ask you after 6 months. So he asked him, how's life? How's marriage? He said, this is an Arabic saying. He said, غُمُومُ زَهْرٍ. So he said, شُرُورُ سَهْرٍ شَهْرٍ سُرُورُ شَهْرٍ غُمُومُ زَهْرٍ فُسُورُ ظَهْرٍ. Beautiful poetry. Those who know Arabic will understand it better. سُرُورُ شَهْرٍ غُمُومُ زَهْرٍ وَكُسُورُ ظَهْرٍ. It's a month of happiness and then a lifetime of sadness and sorrow and the breaking of your back. It's not supposed to be like that. We make marriages like that. It's our fault. This is what we make marriages out to be. We need to create this nature of forgiving, this nature of forgiving other people. It's easy to forgive, it's easy to overlook. Life is too short. Sometimes extended families, problems after problems, disputes after disputes. This was something that happened in pre-Islamic Arabia, in the time of Jahiliyyah, in the days of ignorance. Two tribes used to fight and quarrel, and they used to have disputes for years on end. There's no end. In other words, two tribes, Banu Qurayza and Aws and Khazraj. There were two tribes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about them. وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَى شَفَى جُرُفٍ هَذٍ فَانْهَارَ بِهِ. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, united them. So this was the practice of those who were in the times of ignorance and jahiliyyah. And most of the problems and disputes that take place today, brothers and sisters, are based on misconceptions. Somebody said something, somebody tried to say something, intention was something else, blown out of all proportions. Just hard with life. Life is too short. Somebody said something from one ear in and the other ear out. Inshallah, Allah forgive you, Allah forgive me. Finish. But why do we keep grudges in our hearts? That person is a human being, he's just like you. If somebody said something to me, he's exactly like me. He's a human being, he has the same thoughts, same mind, same brain, same sense, same feelings, same nature. He's a human being. So the way I sometimes may say something to somebody else, he said it to me, fine, Allah forgive you, finish, inshallah. وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْبِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Those who swallow the anger and those who forgive others. Allah loves these people. Allah loves the one who do good. Muhsineen, again, the word ihsan. Our whole religion, Islam, is based on ihsan. And we have been ordered and commanded to be muhsinoon and muhsinat. we have been commanded to be muhsinun and muhsinat. Islam is based on ihsan. بَدَى مَنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهَهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ, the doer of good. And ihsan is in every part of our life. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ الْإِحْسَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ, Allah has written ihsan on everything. To the point that when you slaughter an animal, فَإِذَا قَتَلْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الْقِتْلَ وَإِذَا ذَبَحْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الذِّبْحَ, when you slaughter an animal, slaughter it with excellency, in a good manner. Be proficient in the way you slaughter. Sharpen your knife beforehand. Do not slaughter one animal in the presence of the other. This is all based on ihsan. We have been ordered to be muhsinun. If you look at the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they're filled with teachings of ihsan. Everything we do, ihsan means every single thing we do in our lives, the way we talk, the way we walk, the way we eat, the way we greet, the way we sit, the way we interact, we converse, it's all based on ihsan. When you see this Muslim, you look at him, he is a beautiful Muslim. To the point that many scholars have said that ihsan also entails physically adorning yourself, keeping yourself pure and purified and clean. It's part of being Muslim, because a human being likes to see that which is pleasant. If a person is in a bad physical state, it will harm others. Perfume and good fragrance is considered to be charity, sadaqah. Why? Because it, as it benefits yourself, it benefits other people, and rather its benefit to others is more than it benefits yourself. So this is sadaqah as well. This is ihsan. When you see a person, a human being, a male, you greet him, females, you greet them, you just have a genuine liking for them. This is a beautiful muhsin, Muslim mu'min. This is what Allah and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is advising us to be. Like I was saying yesterday, not somebody who's just grumpy and dull and reserved. This is not what Islam teaches. And it's very unfortunate. I mentioned yesterday as well that the basic sunnah of Islam that we've forgotten is to smile. The basic sunnah. إِنَّ مِنَ الْمَعْرُوفِ أَن تَلْقَى أَخَاكَ بِوَجْهٍ طَلَقٍ. It's out of goodness that you meet your fellow Muslim brother with a smiling, open, unreserved, pleasant face. This is sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many times we see people, you know, so reserved and it's like they've just woken up from some kind of shock. Come on, just say salam, you know, smile gently. You won't lose anything, brother, sister. You won't lose anything. Don't wait for the other person to say salam to you. Al-badi'u bis-salami bari'u min al-kibr. The one who begins with salam first is the one who is saved from pride. Seriously, these are issues, social issues. Sometimes we practice Islam in terms of worshipping Allah, and we think we're very, very pious people because we're praying a lot of prayers and offering a lot of salawat and this and that, and we dress like Muslims. The basic conduct and behavior, social etiquette, they're out of the window. And then a man who thinks he's very, very practicing, he's in the first saf and the row of the masjid, he's worshipping Allah and he's doing all sorts of community work. This work for the masjid and that work for this center. But he goes home and the way he treats his woman is like she's some kind of an animal. There is no reward and no benefit for that man's work outside of his house. Seriously, and I'm being frank here, there is no reward in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First learn how to treat your wife. First learn how to treat your children. And likewise with women. Whatever they do, if they don't treat their husbands in the manner that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded them to treat their husband, everything goes in vain. There is no fa'idah, there is no benefit whatsoever. Islam is based, much of Islam, the majority of the teachings of Islam is based on social etiquette, mu'ashara, husnul mu'ashara, being good in one's social dealings and interaction with other people. When we look at the husband, for example, I mean, and there's actually many, you know, many reasons of these disputes that take place between family members. One of the reasons is that we don't have correct intention. We are not good, okay? That's one problem. And sometimes when we are good as well, when we deal with people in a nice amicable manner. The problem is that our intention is wrong. First of all, it's difficult for us to be good with people. And when we are good as well, then our intentions are incorrect. We do it for some ulterior motive. If I be good to him, then he will be good to me. Oh, this guy, he's got a lot of money, big bank balance. Okay, let me be nice to him. When I need a loan, then I'll ask him and he'll give it to me. We have these kind of intentions. We do not do it for the sake of Allah. According to the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we are good to people, you know what? It's not even for them. If I am good to this brother here, and if I treat him well, it's not even for him. When a man is good to his wife, when the husband is good to his wife, when the wife respects and treats her husband well, it's not even for the husband or the wife. Who is it for? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not even for the person you're being good to. It's not, because why? Because if Allah says that you can't be good here, then we won't be good. Your wife wants to sleep in the morning, doesn't want to wake up for Fajr Salah. She's so sleepy and you feel sorry for her. You want to be good to her. Can you be good to her and say, it's okay, no problem, darling, you know, please. Can you do that? Of course not. You have to wake her up. This is the reason, because your being good to your spouse is based on the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doing good to them is not even for them, it's for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to correct our intentions. The first hadith in most hadith collections. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu says, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات. Actions are according to your intentions. وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. Each individual will receive that which he intends. If you have a right, correct intention for the sake of Allah, then you will gain reward. And if there's no correct intention for the sake of Allah, then there is no reward. We need to correct our intentions. Why are we being good? First of all, the first step is be good. And the second step is that correct the intention. Don't expect a return. This is another problem. Do not expect a return. If I am good to you and if I do it for the sake of Allah, then if you are bad to me, I don't mind. Because I wasn't good to you because I wanted you to be good to me. If I am good to somebody, my sole intention was to please Allah, then whether that person is good to me or not, irrespective of the fact, I don't care. It's not my concern. I've done it for the sake of Allah, then I've left it. Whether that person is good to me or not. But our problem is that we expect a return. We expect to be compensated. We need some form of gratitude. I did this for him and he did not even say thank you to me. Come on. You don't need his thank you. Allah is rewarding you. If you said it, Alhamdulillah. If you didn't say it, Alhamdulillah. No problem. In both scenarios. Don't expect a return from anybody. And sometimes when we are good, it's because in the time of need, he help me, so I have to help him. Or I have to help him. If I don't, I'm going to take it bad. Now your intention of being good to somebody is because you will take it bad. Not just for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Reward gone. Sometimes we go out of our way, we can't even do it. It's so tired or we are. It's physically impossible for us to do something for someone, but we force ourselves only for the reason that people will say something bad or talk about us or they'll take it back. We just force ourselves. Again, wrong intention. It's because people will say something bad. People will talk about you in a negative manner. They will take it back. These are all incorrect intentions. It's not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not a transaction. We are not doing a transaction. You do good to me, so I do good to you. You give me a gift, so I give you a gift. You speak to me in a nice way, so I speak to you in a nice manner. This is not a transaction. ليس الواصل بالمكافئ ولكن الواصل الذي إذا قطعت رحمه وفلها. The one who maintains ties with his family members, with his spouses, as due to the fact that others are good to him, then he is not really maintaining ties. إنما الواصل, the one who is maintaining ties, is the one when others are bad to him, others break off ties, and he maintains the tie. Others break off. This is mujahada. This is what we are required to do. It's easy. If someone is good to me, I am good to them. What's the big deal? That's easy. Yeah, anybody can do that. Any person can do that. You are good to me, I will be good back to you. The true test is when somebody is breaking off ties. Somebody is not good to you. Somebody is being rude to you. And you still go out of your ways and your means to be good to them. This is what is required of us by the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And also, we need to learn to give preference to others. We have become selfish, brothers and sisters. The husband is self-centered, selfish, just thinking about his own concerns and his own needs. The wife's needs and concerns and interests do not matter to him. And likewise the wife. We have become selfish. We need to have this quality of ithar. Of our faith in the Quran, وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصًا, describing the companions of the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. They used to have this quality of ithar. They used to give preference to other people. You know, this ayah was revealed after a particular incident that took place when there was I think I mentioned this as well the other day, that when there was a companion radiallahu ta'ala anhu, sahabi, what happened was that there was a guest came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so he asked that is anybody who is prepared to host this guest and take him home for food? So one companion said, Ya Rasulullah, you know what, I'll take him inshallah, and he took him home, and when he reached home, he said to his wife, we have a guest today. Wife said, we don't have enough food at home, there's only food for like one person. He said, it's okay, just cook it and then we'll see inshallah. The food was put onto the table, onto the spread, and they sat down to eat. And you remember in those days they used to have a lamp. The lamp was, you know, like it used to be like a candle. So the candle was there, the food was placed, and he intentionally, but portraying that it was a mistake, intentionally hit the candle and the light went off. It was completely dark. And in the dark he said to the guest, eat, inshallah, eat. And they were eating because they were used to this kind of atmosphere when lights go out. Like people are in some of our countries, in the continent and some other countries. So they kept on eating. The guest was eating and he was pretending, he was making noise. He was like making sounds, just pretending that he's eating. You know, touching the table, the plate, and just, you know, just pretending that he's eating. Not letting the guest even know or realize that he's not eating because there's not enough food. And the guest was thinking that this host of mine is eating. And he ate food, he was satisfied. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved this practice so much of the sahabi. Subhanallah, he loved this practice of the sahabi so much that he reveals a verse in the Quran that وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصًا. So these people, they give preference to others even if they are hungry themselves. Even if they are hungry themselves, they give preference to other people. These were the qualities of the sahaba radiallahu anhum, brothers and sisters. We need to stop being selfish and self-centered. We need to create this, inculcate and instill this quality of ithar. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. You cannot be a complete believer until you do not like for your brother what you like for your own self. This is your wife, this is your husband. What you like for yourself, you should like for your wife. And the wife should think, what I want for myself, I would want for my husband. Giving preference to other people. Give sacrifice. Sacrifice your own interests and your own pleasures. Marriage is, it's not easy. It's good and it's easy to an extent, but it's not all easy like sometimes people think. When two people live together, it's natural, it's logical that there will be problems. And small issues here and there, fine, no problem. But we need to learn how to deal with these problems. So I was saying, intention should be correct. Do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not expect a return. Do not expect a return. This is general, with all family members, spouses, in every in every situation. Do not expect a return. Do not expect a return. And you know, many scholars have said this, that if you, who wants to be happy in life? Who wants to be happy? You guys want to be happy? Everybody wants to be happy? The greatest recipe or the greatest ingredient to be happy in this world, remember this, if you want to be happy, one thing you do in your life, which is never expect anything from anybody, you'll be the happiest person on the planet. Never expect anything from anybody. If somebody does good to you, consider it as a bonus. Wow, I did not expect this. It's a surprise. The normal habit of yours would be that you don't expect anything from anybody. And if somebody does not do good to you, then you will not be sad. You will not become unhappy. Why? Because you did not expect it anyway in the first place. So do not expect anything from anybody. This is actually the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to make a dua. He used to say, Allahumma ja'alni fi qalbi raja'ak. Allahumma ja'al fi qalbi raja'ak. Waqta' raja'i amman siwak. Oh Allah, Allahumma ja'al fi qalbi raja'ak. In my heart, oh Allah, instill all my hope with you. All my expectations with you. And cut off all my expectations from other than yourself, oh Allah, from the creation of Allah. Our hope are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are good to someone, we do it with the right intention, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will reward us. We'll see the benefit in this world. Allah will reward us, inshaAllah ta'ala. And I was talking about sabr as well last night. It's all of this, being good to people, with the right intention, with the correct intention, giving preference to other people, not being selfish and self-centered, and inculcating the quality of izar and giving preference to others, all of this requires one important quality. Again, it's to do with the heart. Sabr, patience. A man or a woman, a human being, an individual who does not have sabr in his life, seriously, he will have a problematic life. And this is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about sabr, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. The reward for sabr, for patience, for fortitude, is such that it's without any limit. Without any limit. إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. This, all of this requires sabr, patience. And if a person does not have patience, then seriously, you have to work hard at it. You have to work hard at it. Sabr is something that we have to work. It doesn't come easy. There are ways and forms and means of acquiring this quality of sabr, of patience in our life. There are ways and means. So this is the greatest remedy. Have sabr and have patience. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us guidelines of having sabr and patience and trying to control one's anger. And also, if somebody has a genuine problem of anger, then you should go and have some anger management treatment. Not a problem. Seriously, you can go and get some treatment then. Because some people have this problem of anger. And anger is the opposite of sabr. Sabr is swallowing the anger. And anger is not being able to control yourself. That's anger, ghadab. And Allah talks about ghadab. You know, there was a companion, Sahabi, he came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, awsini wa awjid. Please give me advice, a nasiha, but make it short and brief. Why did he say make it short and brief? Because he was in a hurry, and he said, just please, I just want one thing, I need to know. Just one small thing, I'm passing by you, please, just tell me something short. Small advice. There's nothing wrong in doing that. Sometimes, you know, you can have somebody give me one nasiha, one advice, just make it short, one word to it. And many scholars do that. The sunnah of the Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Before you depart, give me one nasiha, one small advice, what would you give me? The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, what did he say to him? One word. لا تغضب. لا تغضب. Do not become angry. Do not become angry. This statement of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم entails in it oceans of meaning, full of wisdom. Because if a person controls himself and is able to swallow his or her anger and is able to exercise sabr and patience, then that is a key and that is a root and that is a cause for prosperity in his whole life. So sabr is something that we need to, as I said, you know, we need to exercise. In regard to, you know, this husband-wife relationship, I just want to talk briefly about husband-wife relationship. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as I said, there's a hadith here. Aisha radiallahu anha says, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَكْمَلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِيمَانًا أَحْسَنَهُمْ خُلُقًا وَأَلْطَفَهُم بِأَهْلِهِ. Imam al-Tirmidhi radiallahu anhu relates this hadith that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the most complete believer, إِنَّ مِنْ أَكْمَلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِيمَانًا. Who has the most complete iman? His iman and faith and belief is the most complete. Who? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, أَحْسَنُهُمْ خُلُقًا. The one who has the best manners, the greatest of manners and characteristics. And the one, and he said, وَأَلْطَفَهُمْ بِأَهْلِهِ. And the one who is the most gentle. The word أَلْطَف is from the word look. Some people have a name called أَلْطَف. It's from the word look. Look, which means gentleness. Look means gentleness. One of the names of Allah, يَا لَطِيفُ. One of the names of Allah is لَطِيف. We say, يَا لَطِيفُ, O gentle one. It has the meaning of gentleness in it. وَأَلْفَقَهُمْ بِأَهْلِهِ. The one who is the most gentle to his family. Gentle is just one word I've used. I've not done justice to that, the word. Because English language can never do justice to the Arabic language anyway. We try our best. The English language can never, can any language, forget just the English language, no language on the face of the earth can do real justice to the Arabic language. Translations are translations, it's the closest thing. The closest thing. There are words like the word taqwa in the Arabic language. It's impossible to translate that word. Some say fear of Allah, piety, God consciousness. It means these three things and much more. It has like 20-25 meanings in that one word, taqwa. If you want to translate taqwa, you have to start counting the list. Taqwa means one, two. You can't translate it. The word fitna in Arabic has many meanings. Trial, tribulation, test, examination, and beyond. The Arabic language is just a unique language, and all the translations are like trying your best to get close to it. So, وَأَلْطَفَهُمْ بِأَهْلِهِ. Again, there's a hadith. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَكْمَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِيمَانًا أَحْسَنُهُمْ خُلُقًا وَخِيَارُكُمْ خِيَارُكُمْ لِنِسَائِهِمْ. The best amongst you is the one who is best to his women. There's a hadith here, and listen to this hadith. This is an amazing hadith as well. It's one of my favorites. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha relates, she was asked, سُئِلَ كَيْفَ كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا خلى في بيته. How was the behavior, the conduct of Rasulullah, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he was in the midst of his home, in the midst of his house? إذا خلى في بيته. What did he say? He would ask the great, the Prophet of Allah, the leader of the Muslims, in the midst of his house, how would he be? How would he be? What did she reply? What did she say? Listen to the words of the Messenger of Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha. كَانَ أَلْيَنَ النَّاسِ. كَانَ أَلْيَن. The word أَلْيَن in Arabic. لَيَّن. He was the softest of individuals. The most tender of individuals. The most calm and the most gentle. لَيَّنُ الْقَلْبِ. لَيَّن means somebody who's gentle, soft. By nature. Today we think it's good to be, you know, strong. ليس الشديد بالسرعة. That's another hadith. ليس الشديد بالسرعة. إنما الشديد الذي يملك نفسه عند الغضب. Being strong is not by your physical might and power. So who is strong according to Islam? The one who is able to control himself when angry, that is the real powerful and mighty person and strong individual. We think we've got all the power. Anyone, like I was mentioning actually in one of the morning sessions, like one individual came to a sheikh and said, you know what, I have so much awe and ra'ab and you know, power over my family. Is like when I go into my house, my kids can't even come running to me and greet me. They're all like statues. They freeze. Daddy's coming. They all freeze, like, you know, that's how much awe I have. So much fear they have in their hearts. MashaAllah. You know, he was like boasting. The sheikh said to him, why, when you go into your house, you become some kind of a monster? It looks like it. It looks like it. You probably turn into a monster, and that's why they got all the fear. That's not what a dad is supposed to be like. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would take Hassan and Hussein, lift them up, kiss them. يَمْسَحُ رُؤُوسَ الصَّبِيَانِ. He used to place his hands on children. We dealt with his dealings with children. This is not what's required of men. كَانَ أَلْيَنَ النَّاسِ. And then look after that, what she says. عَائِشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا. بَسَّامًا ضَحَّاكًا. بَسَّامًا ضَحَّاكًا. He used to be extremely smiling. He used to always smile. From the word تَبَسُّم. Tabassum means to smile. And some females have this name, Tabassum. Tabassum means to smile. Bassaman. He used to always smile at home. This is at home. It's not outside here in the masjid. So it's not an act. Remember, it's not outside in the masjid or just in the marketplace. So it's not an act. It's not something that you just put on. I could be putting something on in front of you right now. I hope not, inshallah. I mean, whatever I'm saying is for me first and foremost. Inshallah, may Allah give all of us the ability to practice. It's not an act. It's easy for us to be good outside. But inside the house, when the going gets tough, when you have to live with somebody 24/7, that's when it's difficult. كَانَ بَسَّامًا. And then she said, ضَحَّاكًا. He used to laugh. He used to joke around with his wife. There are many incidents. And then there's another hadith where she says that I went with once with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I was quite young, and I wasn't, I was quite slim in the beginning of our marriage. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was walking, and he, with a lot of people, everybody, you know, his companions, and he said to the people, تَقَدَّمُوا. Everybody move ahead, go a bit far, inshallah. So all the companions, they went away, they went ahead. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Aisha radiallahu anha, تَعَالَيْ حَتَّى أُسَابِقُكِ. Come on, let's have a race. This is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying to his wife, come on, let's have a race. You want a race? فَسَابَقْتُهُ. We had a race and I overtook him. Because I was slim. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha is saying. فَسَجَتَ عَلْمِي. So he didn't say anything. He just remained quiet. Until a time came when حَمَلْتُ اللَّحَمْ. I put on a bit of flesh. And you know, I wasn't that slim anymore. وَبَدُنْتُ وَسَمِنْتُ. I became quite healthy and put on a bit of weight. فَخَرَجْتُ مَعَهُ صلى الله عليه وسلم في بعض الصالحين. Again, I went in some kind of journey with him. And again, he said to his companions, تَقَدَّمُوا. Go ahead, everybody. فَتَقَدَّمُوا. They all went. And then he said, come on, تعالي أسابقك. Let's have a race. And Aisha رضي الله عنها said, فَسَبَقَنِي. This time he beat me. He overtook me. فَجَعَلَ يَضْحَكُ صلى الله عليه وسلم ويقول. He started smiling and laughing, and he said, هَذِهِ بِتِلْكِ. It's one all now. This time is for that time. One all. In other words, he did not want her to at least, and he didn't say that to say, look, yeah, now I've overtook you. No. He did not want her to feel sad that she was overtaken. Remember, you overtook me that time. It's okay, don't worry too much. It's okay, I've beaten you this time, but you, a few years back, you overtook me, so it's equal now. It's not that I've taken the lead. This is what the ulama explains. This is the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. ما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصنع في بيته. What would he do in the midst of his house? كان في مهنة أهله. في فلجين. He was in the service of his family. And he mentioned, there's many hadith. استوصوا بالنساء خيرا. I advise you to treat your women in an honorable way. In a gentle and honorable manner. And this is actually the first right and the most important haq and right of the woman, of the wife. The first right of the woman and the most important right of the woman is good treatment. حُسْنُ الْمُعَاشَرَةِ Allah says in the Quran, فَإِنْسَاكٌ بِمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ تَسْرِيحٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ The most important right of the wife is good treatment. حُسْنُ الْمُعَاشَرَةِ Good treatment. وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ Allah says in the Quran, treat them in an honorable manner. Treat them in an honorable manner. وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ And if you dislike something of your wife, then think about her good qualities. This is the first, you know, the right, the women have, the wife have many rights in Islam, you know, financial support, this, that, and the other. I don't want to talk about any of those rights. But the most important right which they possess and the responsibility of the husband is to treat her with extreme gentleness and to treat her with honor, with respect. Respect. You know, this is so important, respect. Sometimes we forget that our women deserve respect. The man always just criticizes the wife. Everything she does, everything she says, every act she carries out is just condemning her, degrading her, disrespecting her, picking faults in her. The man needs to get a life here. You know, what kind of man is this? You know, just, that's what we say in England. I don't know if you use that phrase. But what kind of man is this? Every time she does anything, I'm picking. The fault is too much or it's too less. It's never exactly what you want. Either it's too less and too much. And according to Islam, you know, this is, you might think it's controversial, Allahu A'lam, but according to Islam, you know what? It's not even the responsibility of the wife to cook for her husband. The wives are really happy now. And you guys, afterwards, you're going to all surround me. If she does, she gets great. No, this is from a hadith. Scholars are mentioning it. Really. There's a hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا هُنَّ عَوَامٌ عِنْدَكُمْ These wives of yours, these women of yours, they have come to you. They have restricted themselves to you. They've left their parents, they've left their mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters. They've left everything and you have a right over them. That they've restricted themselves to your house. They stay in your house, they stay with you. لَيْسَ تَمْلِكُونَ شَيْئًا غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ Beyond the fact that they have restricted themselves to your house, you do not own anything. This is the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in light of this hadith, the jurists, the scholars, the fuqaha of the various schools of thought, they have deducted and deduced and extracted this ruling that, you know, the woman, to the point, they go into extreme detail, but they say that if a woman does not want to cook, then a man actually sometimes has to go and cook himself or go and buy prepared, ready-made food from the restaurant and give it to her in her lap. Really, this is what the ulama mentioned. But if she does cook, she gets great amount of reward. Great amount of reward. A reward that is بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ If she does. But you know these rulings of Sharia, why Allah has prescribed these rulings? Is because, you see, if things are expected, if things are demanded, and especially this great problem we have, the mother-in-law, daughter-in-law problem, in Islam, it's not a requirement. She doesn't have to serve her parents-in-law. She doesn't have to. But if she does, she gets great amount of reward. Now, look at the wisdom behind it. The wisdom behind it is that, look, mother-in-laws and father-in-laws and parents-in-laws, they need to understand that this daughter-in-law, this wife who has come into the house, she does not have a responsibility. She does not have to do the household chores. She does not have to clean, cook, and look after the whole household. She doesn't. But if she does, she gets great reward. Now, if they understand this ruling, if the mother-in-law understands this ruling, okay, she understands this, what will happen? She will not expect anything. She will not demand anything. She will not get angry or upset if she is slightly less. If the fault was too much, she won't get anything. She'll think, you know, she doesn't even have to cook. At least she's cooked. Forget extra salt. At least she's cooked. There will be no expectation, no demand. And remember, what will happen? If the daughter-in-law does something good, then the mother-in-law will appreciate it. She will know and realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not made it compulsory on her to do any khidmah for me. She doesn't have to do anything, but she is doing it for the sake of Allah and she is looking after us and looking after me. She will appreciate it. She will thank the daughter-in-law. She will show her gratitude. And you know, with women, once you show them more gratitude, more appreciation, the more they do. So this is the hikmah. The mother-in-law will show appreciation and the daughter-in-law will in fact do more. She will do more. But the difference will be that here she will do it out of her own desire. She won't take it as a burden. And if we think it's all necessary, compulsory, she must do it, then the mother-in-law is demanding it, expecting it. You know, she will be expecting it. Slightly lax in the work, she'll get angry. And the daughter-in-law as well, why is she angry on me? And she will do it, but out of, you know, a grudge, out of frustration. And the whole atmosphere becomes sour because of this. We need to learn the rules of Islam. We need to learn these rulings of Islam. The woman, the man is told by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has been commanded to treat his wife bil ma'roof, in an honorable manner, in a gentle manner. And then there's another hadith as well, which I will not go into, but this is very, very important. And there's another hadith. لا يفرق مؤمن مؤمنة إن كره منها خلقا رضي منها آخر. Imam al-Tirmidhi radiallahu anhu relates this hadith. He says, إذن أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه سيدنا the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, لا يفرق مؤمن مؤمنة. A believer, male believer, means a husband should not dislike and hate his wife. If he dislikes one quality of hers, there are many other qualities that you can like. Overlook this one bad quality. This is what we need to do. Like some scholars say that, you know, there's a clock. A clock that stops working, you know, the batteries are flat. If the clock does not work, it stops working at 2 p.m. And nobody changed the battery for like 3 days. Every day, 2 o'clock p.m. and 2 o'clock a.m., the clock will say the truth. The clock will speak the truth twice. Meaning, if you want to search for good qualities, every individual, every human has good, even if it's only 2 good things. So look for the, search for the good things and overlook the bad qualities. Overlook them. Learn to forgive and forget. Create this rahmah and mercy within your heart. You know, there's a companion, Sahabi radiallahu anhu, came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam complaining about his wife. My wife's like this, she's like that, and she's whinging, and she's always like just mouthing me, and she's rude, and she's always whinging, and she's always, she disrespects me, there's like a whole list of complaints. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's listening, and then you know what he said after that? He said, Saliqa, divorce her. He was taken aback. What? Divorce her. Then he thought, he said, La, Ya Rasulullah, La asbiru anha. I can't even live without her. So he said, Amsika even, then keep her. The message that was given by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here was that if you are complaining so much about her, if she's such an evil, wicked woman, then what are you doing with her? Let her go. The reason being that he came with like 500 complaints and evil things about his woman. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam straight away said, divorce her, he goes, wait, she looks after me as well. What will I do? Oh, she cooks for me, or she does this. She also looks after my children. He started thinking about the good qualities. He came with a list of bad qualities. When he said, Saliqa, straight away he said, no, she's got these good qualities. I can't even live without her. So he said, I'm sick of her. Then live with her and look at the good qualities. Overlook the bad qualities. So this was the teaching of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would never deal with his wife in an aggressive tone. You know, there was this one sheikh, rahimahullah ta'ala, from the subcontinent. He was actually one of the sheikhs of one of my teachers, one of my sheikhs. He says, I heard it from my teacher, he was saying that about a sheikh that in 55 years of his marriage, he never spoke to his wife in an aggressive tone. Imagine. You know, we think a pious individual is the one who Allahu Akbar, so much devotion and khushu and khudu, and the one who has the longest thawb and the greatest amama and the good. These are things that are important. Okay, I'm not saying they're not important. We look for miracles. That the sheikh, he you know, pulls out a big subha, and you know, he does this and something happens. The greatest miracle, according to ulama, this is the greatest miracle. Imagine living with your wife for 55 years. He did not even change his tone and manner of speech. He was a sheikh. He was a great sheikh. He was a GP as well, by profession, and a sheikh at the same time. Imagine. And there's another story about him as well, that he once went to one of his students' houses, and he was invited. He ate there. And when he was leaving, he said to his students or his associates, he said that, Jazakallah khair for inviting me, and Jazakallah may Allah reward you for this invitation, for this food. And also say, you know, Jazakallah to your wife. We should also do that. You know, when you go to somebody's house, tell the women of the household, Jazakallah. They you know, the man takes all the credit. I invited you and all the food there. You should learn, this is a sunnah as well. And then he said, just call your wife, you know, I'll just say, you know, thanks to her as well, inshallah. So he called his wife and came into the corridor, observing the rules of hijab. He said to her that, you know, sister, Jazakallah, mashallah, may Allah reward you. And she started crying. And he said, why are you crying? Did I say something wrong? So when she stopped, she said, Sheikh, I've been married to this guy for 40 years, he's never complimented my food. In 40 years of marriage, he's never thanked me. First time in my life I'm hearing that somebody said, Jazakallah for cooking food. This is a problem. Appreciate. And likewise, I'm not just talking about husbands as well, likewise women as well. We have a problem, and that's another problem in itself. You know, in December, I mentioned, I had a talk at the RIF conference in Toronto. I gave a whole topic, detail. I mean, these topics, I'm just mentioning some points here and there, but I had a lengthy talk on the rights of the husband and the wife. And I talked about the husband, the wife for like 30, 35 minutes. I talked only 10 minutes for the husband. And yesterday I mentioned that somebody came to me and said that, Jazakallah. But I'll tell you something else. I only spoke 8 minutes. And you know what I said? I'll say one or two things. I just said, women need to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, and then I'll tell you what happened. So this is what I said. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created men as the amir of the household. The greatest right of the husband, the wife, is that treating them, what did we say? Bil ma'ruf, treating them in an honorable manner. And the husband's greatest right that he deserves is respect. Respect. The wife needs to think and comprehend in her mind that the greatest person on the planet is my husband. A woman who thinks that there's nobody on the face of the earth as good as my husband, then that marriage will be full of blessings and barakah and prosperity. Respect. The man Allah has given him this quality of being an amir. الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض وبما أنفقوا من أموالهم. Allah has made, you know, even a small journey of a lifetime, you need an amir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, this is a lifelong journey. Husband, wife, children, this is your lifelong journey. You need somebody to take the decision, somebody to make the final, of course with mutual discussion and mashwara, but somebody to take the ultimate final decision. And seriously, sisters who are listening, you must respect your husband. You must respect them, because this is the honor Allah has given them. This is the respect that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. Just look at these one or two hadith. In Sunnah al-Tirmidhi, Imam al-Tirmidhi radiallahu anhu relates, Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لو كنت آمرا أحدا أن يسجد لأحد لأمرت النساء أن يسجدن لأزواجهن. If I was to command and order anyone to make sujood and prostrate in front of anyone else, if I was to, you know, Sharia is haram to make sajda to any created thing. But if I was to allow that, I would have commanded the wife to make sajda in front of the husband. because of the rank and position Allah has given the husband. أجمع امرأة مات وزوجها عنها راض دخلت الجنة. Any woman who passes away in a state that her husband is happy with her, دخلت الجنة. She'll enter paradise quickly. It's so easy for sisters to enter Jannah. المرأة إذا صلت خمسها وصامت شهرها وأطاعت زوجها دخلت الجنة من أجل أبواب شرع. A woman says her fast time prayers, observes the fast of Ramadan, obeys and respects her husband, looks after the husband, she will enter paradise from whichever door she wants to enter. These are the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They need to understand, sisters need to understand that we need to respect. And of course, husbands need to deserve and earn that respect as well. That's an important point. But they need to respect their husbands. Look after them. Be gentle with them. Don't just make excuses of mood swings. Don't make excuses of PMT and mood swings. That it's always just a mood swing and we're women and that's it. Yes, women are sensitive. They are fragile. And Allah has created them like that. And that's why the husband, to a certain extent, needs to look, have mercy and rahmah and overlook and forgive and forget. But at the same time, the wife should not misuse this. Do not take advantage of this. The wife on her part also should ensure that the marriage and the family atmosphere is built on rahmah and mercy. InshaAllah. So I'm going to end with this. And I thought, you know, as I said, I just talked about the husband at the conference in Canada. And this is something that really struck me. I mentioned this to some people in England and the UK. And I hope I don't offend anybody with this, but seriously, there's some kind of problem in these areas of feminism. We don't have that much in the UK. I talked 40 minutes about the rights of the woman. And men treat your women like this and treat them well. And 8 minutes on the man and a woman came to me straight up their talk running. I don't accept all these hadiths of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The 2-3 hadith. This is what was in his time, right now. What's this respect? We are both equal. The man works, the woman works. There's no respect. To the man, you're trying to say that a man has like slightly above. I said, no, I'm not saying that. See, you hear how much I talked about the woman. And she was like, JazakAllah khair for your advice, but inshallah, you know, I have to move on. This is a problem in our community, brothers and sisters. Feminism. This feminist movement. We have to implement the true teachings of Allah, His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm not saying cultural things. The true teachings of the Qur'an and Sunnah. But we have to stick by the Qur'an and Sunnah and the teachings of Allah, His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whether we like it or whether we don't like it. These are the teachings of Allah, His Messenger. We are Muslims. We submit to the will and command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we accept everything wholeheartedly, inshaAllah. And we just say, أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ